You've probably heard about how ChatGPT is helping instructional designers work more quickly and creatively, but did you know that you can actually add a ChatGPT to your Articulate Storyline project so that you can power entire interactions by artificial intelligence? If you didn't, then you're watching the right video because we're gonna explore some really cool use cases and I'm gonna show you exactly how you can add ChatGPT to your Storyline project. Okay, so let's hop into Storyline and take a look at how this all works. So first thing, obviously this is very bare bones. If you're using this in production, probably at the very least, it would be nice to add like a loading animation that you can do with layers or however you want whenever the AI response is loading. We don't want to just stare at nothing while it takes a few seconds to load, so that would be nice, but we're not going to get bogged down with that. We're just going to take a look at the functionality and how we can get these AI responses into Storyline. So first thing we need to do here is take a look at the variables. You will need to adjust the project variables, but I'm trying to make it so you need to do hardly any coding at all. You don't need to learn how to code to do this. So over here on the right, let's open those project variables, and there are three variables we're going to need at least. The first one you're going to need to create this variable is called token. So all lowercase, T-O-K-E-N, you need to spell it exactly like that. And that is going to be equal to your API key, which is what's gonna let you generate these AI responses. The next variable you're gonna need is the text entry variable. This is generated automatically whenever you create a text entry box where the user can enter their own response. So whenever we created this text entry box, it generated that text entry variable for us. So you could have that, you could rename them, you could have multiple of them, just keep track of that, of course. And then we're also going to need to create a variable, a text variable, for the AI response. So if you want to follow along with this tutorial, you can name it AI lowercase, then capital R for response. So those are the three essential variables, one for the user to enter their text, one for us to include our API key, which is what we'll need to generate these responses. And then we're going to need this variable to hold the AI's response that we can then display on the screen like we did here. Okay, so before we go any further, we are going to need the API key from OpenAI because this is how you're going to access what's called an API, which is what's going to let you use their AI technology in your own application, which in this case is a Storyline project. So you're going to want to go to platform.openai.com/account/API-keys. I'll include this link in the description. You're going to need to probably create an account and potentially include credit card information to access this API, but you do need to get to this page, so go through the steps necessary. Pause the video now if you'd like. We need to get here. If you're worried about cost, I did pull up this page for you. This is OpenAI's pricing as of right now. We're going to be using this GPT 3.5 Turbo API. They do have a more powerful one called GPT-4. As of right now, this isn't open to the public, but it will be very shortly. But you can see the costs here. For example, if you're using their base model, which the context, I explained it in my longer video, but 1,000 context tokens is essentially 750 words. So in most cases, you'll be using this as long as your request isn't exceeding 3,000 words. And then this is the price per 750 words that you're either sending or in this case, receiving. So a fraction of a penny. So per 750 words or so. So it's pretty minimal. So especially with just testing around, you'll probably spend less than a dollar and like a whole day's worth of testing. But keep in mind, you do pay based on how much this gets used. So if you are using this in a production environment with tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, or millions of learners, there is going to be costs associated with it. Okay, so that's the pricing. You can go get there by going to openai.com/pricing. But let's hop back over to the API keys. So you're going to need to create a new secret key. So click on that button right there. We're going to name it. You can name it whatever you want. I'm going to call mine throwaway because you don't want to share this key with anyone, but obviously you're going to see this key because you're here for this video. So this is important. I'm going to pause here. This key is essentially access to your OpenAI account. If someone gets their hands on this key, they can send hundreds of thousands, millions of requests if they want, and it's going to charge whoever's card is on the account. So think of this like a super, super secure password. With that being said, I have a disclaimer to share with you. Using the approach that we're using, where we're just going to kind of put this key in Storyline as a variable, it is not very secure. It makes it so that someone who is like a developer savvy user can kind of like inspect the code of the e-learning project, and somewhere in there, they will be able to find this secret key. It's because we're just putting this in the browser. Now, in some cases, if you are serving an audience on a learning management system that is very like secure to even get there, the question you need to ask yourself is, are you worried about your employees or your learners essentially finding this API key and then doing something malicious with it, like, you know, sending hundreds of thousands of requests? Unlikely, but it is still a risk. The way to do this fully secured is to use server-side programming that isn't super compatible with an Articulate Storyline project. It would need to be something done on the LMS side for convenience. I'm not going to get into it, but just keep in mind this is like not the safest way to do this, and like use this approach at your own risk, especially if you're going to use this in like a portfolio project. Keep in mind someone will be able to inspect that code if they want and get access to that API key. So be really careful. Maybe you can set limits on the usage and stuff, I'm not sure, but need to get that disclaimer out there. Okay, so once you've generated the key, you go ahead and copy it, and then we're going to hop back over into the Storyline project, and we are going to open up our variables, and then we can go ahead and change the value of this token variable to exactly what that token is. So I'm just going to paste in the token and click OK. And that will be enough to let us communicate with the OpenAI API and get ChatGPT into our Storyline project. So now we're going to take a look at the code that, again, I'm going to give to you. But for those of you who are more tech savvy, I want to just walk you through how it works so you have an idea of what's going on here. Now I've pulled it open in Visual Studio Code. This just like color codes things and makes it easier to see and organize. So we're going to take it line by line. So this right here sets up a variable to get access to Articulate Storyline. It gets access to the player so that we can read Storyline variables and set Storyline variables. After that, these three variables are things that you are going to change every time you want to generate an AI response. So the system request, this is what you're requesting of ChatGPT essentially. So in this case, notice I said, you are a language coach who helps people write in conversational English. I'm going to write a sentence in response to the following prompt. Tell your friend what you're doing this afternoon. Again, I'm telling ChatGPT, here's what I'm asking people. Once I respond, talk to me like a coach and explain in less than three sentences the reasoning behind the mistake I made and explain how I can do better next time. So these are all practices I took from my ChatGPT for Instructional Designers video. So of course, check that out. That's kind of a good thing to watch before doing this. Again, if the response does not need any improvement, tell me that I did a good job. Here's my response. And then notice that response will come whenever the user enters their open text entry in Storyline. And I'll show you how that works. So you'll need to adjust that to tell ChatGPT what you're actually asking of it. You're also going to want to tell us what is the user input variable that we're getting the data from. So in this case, it's text entry. You might change the default variable name, but this is what we're reading from the user. And that's what, in this case, is going to be that next message. And then we also want to tell the code what the AI output variable will be. So in my case, I named it AI response. I wanted to make it so that you can adjust these things though. So that you don't have to just use the exact variable name I used in my code. So if you were going to change this, you would want to change the text between the quotes. So say my user input variable was called like user response, user text response. I would change it to user text response, but I want to make sure that we still have those double quotes before and after the name of the variable. So very important there. I'm going to undo that. Okay. So after that, I want to actually pull that data. So I made it simple for you. So you just need to change the text variable here, but I created a variable called user entry, and I get the variable from Storyline that shares the same name as whatever you entered here. If this is confusing, don't worry. You can skip the code explanation. This is just for people who want to dive deeper. This next variable sets up our authentication with the API. It follows a specific format. I don't need to bog you down with that, but I made it nice and easy so that we just get that token variable's value from Storyline. So I kind of set up that code for you. All you have to do is enter it right here in the default value for the token variable, and the code will pull the rest. Now we create a function. So this is the endpoint for the chat API. This is what OpenAI makes available so that you can basically access ChatGPT via an API, put simply. This is just some general HTTP request stuff. You don't need to worry about what's going on here. Here's where we plug in the authentication variable so that we can actually get access to the API. And this, again, is what other people can do if they ever get access to your token. We're telling which model we want to use. This is where we tell it we want to use this GPT 3.5 turbo model. If we go back over here to the pricing, it doesn't have it here, but there's a page on the OpenAI website that will tell you how to access the different models, but we're just using GPT 3.5 turbo. This is where we plug in the system request. Again, it shows the variable here. I'm essentially just making it so you can edit it up here, and then it will plug it in down here where it has to actually go to work, basically. And then here's where we enter that user entry. So we send the request, and then we do some good old HTTP request fun to actually get the data back from OpenAI's server. And then we do some parsing on that data to actually spit out the response, the next chat message in this conversation we're having with the AI. So again, this might be confusing. Don't worry. Once we get that response, I set it to a variable, and then I use player.setvar to set the variable in Storyline. Whatever the variable is, in this case, it's AI response. It pulls it from up here, and then it sets it equal to whatever the AI text is that we got back from the OpenAI API. And then finally, the last line of the code is just calling the function. So there are ways to simplify this. I just wanted to make it nice and easy so that you can just literally select all of this, copy it, and then head on over to Storyline and paste it in. So I'm going to show you what that looks like now. In this case, we want to execute that code whenever we click on the submit button. So I'm just going to actually delete my current execute JavaScript trigger and show you how to make it from scratch. So we're going to click the submit button. We're going to do create a new trigger. We are going to execute JavaScript. And then we're going to click on where it says JavaScript right here, and we're going to paste in all of that code that you just copied and pasted. Again, the only things you're going to need to change are this first line where we actually tell the API what we want it to do. And then we need to tell it which user input variable we are accessing and which output variable in Storyline we want to put that response in. So again, these are the only three things you'll need to change for doing this. I would suggest using a code editor to change these things, because obviously it's going to be such a bigger hassle editing that here than it is going to be editing it in Visual Studio Code, where it's like I turned on word wrap, so it's like so much easier to see what the actual instruction is. Also important, just a mistake that I can foresee happening here. Notice I use single quotes here. Respond to the following prompt. If I were to use double quotes here, it would kind of like close this string, and that's not going to work. So avoid double quotes for sure. And because this, I don't want to get too bogged down, but I guess long story short, using a tool like this, if things start changing wonky colors and you get like error messages underlined, like what happened here when I use double quotes, you're gonna kind of know where you messed up. So Visual Studio Code, I'll include a link to it. I highly recommend grabbing that if you're gonna be even editing simple code like this, even just editing these strings. So once we have this code here, once we have these things set up, I'm going to click on OK. I want it to happen when the user clicks rectangle one, which is this rectangle right here. And that's literally all there is to it. When we publish this, I'll show you just to make sure it works. I'm going to publish. If you want to do testing, I recommend going to web right here, and we'll just publish a web package. We will click on publish. We will view the project. And here we have it. We can go ahead and test it out. We will say, I am reading book in pool. And if we click on submit, it takes a minute. You did a good job conveying your activity. Use the correct preposition and article. Instead of saying in pool, it should be in the pool. I am reading. It seems like a mess up. I'm reading a book in the pool would have been better. We did tell the We did tell ChatGPT to keep it to three sentences or less, so maybe it would have done better with more space to respond. I also want to emphasize, like, the ChatGPT, the API isn't perfect. You can make it a lot better by doing the prompt engineering and getting the prompt really good, but it's probably not going to be as good as like a real human reviewing this stuff, but it can help a lot. It can definitely give more specific feedback than you would get from pre-programmed feedback, especially if the user responses are variable or open text text-based and not simple multiple choice. So keep in mind, this will not be perfect. GPT-4 will do a lot better job than GPT 3.5 Turbo, but it is more expensive. And again, it isn't in open access just yet. By the time you're watching this video, it may be though. So there we have it. I'll include a link in the description so that you can go ahead and download this file and play around with it however you like. Some common mistakes I would say to be aware of: make sure that your variable names here in Storyline are spelled and capitalized exactly as they are in the JavaScript. If one capitalization is off or there's one random letter in there that shouldn't be, this is going to be completely broken. So make sure that these variable names match these ones exactly, and make sure that token is spelled all lowercase exactly like this. Also make sure that the token is set, make sure that's spelled correctly. That might be a common mistake, is entering that inaccurately. Should be nice and easy because it's just copy and paste. I think those are going to be the main ones. And then of course, if you enter what I showed you earlier, if in the code, if you enter something that kind of like breaks this string, then the whole thing is going to be broken. And so that's just something to keep in mind, like where these quotation marks are. If you're using Visual Studio Code, you want it to look just like this, where it's all orange, nothing is underlined in red. But yeah, if you like delete this and put AI response and you don't have the quotation marks around it, it is not going to work. It's going to be completely broken. So those are the common mistakes. If you're having any other trouble with it, let us know in the comments and we'll see if we can help you out. So I hope you enjoyed this. I've been really excited about putting this video out there and seeing what you're all going to create using this technology. I've also put together some other use cases that I could think of. I'm sure you could think of some others that are just as cool, if not cooler, but here are some of the main uses I see for this as it is right now. The obvious one, evaluating open text responses. We haven't been able to do that in any meaningful way before, so this solves that problem in a big way. Students can write anything from a single sentence to a long essay, and we can use AI to evaluate it and give them specific feedback about where they messed up. So that's huge. That's the first thing that came to mind for me. This is also really cool. If we generate quiz questions or supplemental content based on where learners are struggling or need more help. So if we see that, yeah, this user is spending a lot of time on a certain part of piece of content, or maybe they answered a few questions incorrectly on a specific topic, we can use AI to generate questions tailored specifically to the area that they're struggling, and then generate answer choices, and it can do a pretty good job at that. So we can not only use it for just evaluating responses, but also generating new content or questions based on where the student needs extra help. So personalizing the learning experience with AI. We can also embed a chatbot in the experience that's trained on the course content. So if the user like has a question, we can literally have a coach, not just like an OpenAI trained coach where it's trained on the entire internet of data, but you can actually train these models to reference only specific documents or specific web pages. So you could train it essentially on your course content, and then the user, maybe as a refresher or as they're going through the experience, can just ask it a question like they would ask a coach who's, you know, available via direct message or text, and get an instant response from the AI. So really cool stuff there as well. And then of course, getting really advanced, you can actually pull the user's performance data through whatever XAPI data you have associated with that user, and then generate content or recommendations accordingly. So of course, getting more complex there, but that's just where my mind goes, especially being like an XAPI nerd and spending a lot of hours diving into XAPI. There's some really cool potential overlaps with that and artificial intelligence. So as far as next steps are concerned, feel free to go ahead and grab the practice file with a link in the description. That will let you start playing around with this, and you can get up and running with it as soon as today. That's where I'll include the code for this as well. If you're all on board with using artificial intelligence, then you can also join the waitlist for Devlin.ai. This is the tool that we're looking to build with and for the community to help us leverage AI to work more quickly and creatively. So it's an AI assistant for instructional designers. It's pretty sweet. We're still in the early stages, and we're not rushing it. So feel free to join the waitlist and get involved there. And then of course, feel free to subscribe. There's always more AI and ID content coming. AI is obviously changing the face of the work that we're doing. So feel free to subscribe because we're on board with it, and we'd love to have you along with the journey as well. So thanks for making it to the end of the video, and I will see you in the next one.